Remember, finding great car service starts with an investigation.
How you doing, everybody? My name is Chris.
I'm Gary.
And welcome to Car Service Investigations.
Hi, Internet World. We're back.
That there one month we are. We took off.
Hey, see, I changed it for you, Chris. I gave you a little bit more of an insight. I could go there, but you could see, folks,
right?
Split screen because I moved. And that's why you had a hiatus from CSI for a month. But we're glad to be back.
It smells better in my room.
Well, you know, fortunately, we weren't in that room. So, you know, of course, right. You know, so we're all good. So how you been, bro?
David.
You doing good?
Doing well. Doing well.
Cool. It's good awesome.
To see
awesome.
On the split
awesome.
Screen.
Yeah. So what are we talking about today, brother?
We're going to talk about diagnostics.
Ooh.
And why you should pay for it.
Ooh, we're going there, huh?
We're going there because
yeah, we're
I
going
personally
there.
Think it's more trustworthy to be told up front there's a diagnostic fee versus being told that fee will be waived if you fix the car.
Yeah, but see, we allow that to happen, man.
Well, so
that's
fee
the being
problem.
Waived. Yeah.
You're right. That's the problem. For decades, we've allowed this. But what consumers need to understand is when you're told that fee is being waived, that fee is being built back into the labor for the repair being done.
Oh, they're God,
padding,
yes, totally.
They're padding labor. They're padding the parts. And they're getting their
agreed.
Money back.
Yeah, they're, you know, it's like when we look back in the days, we had those shop fees, right? It was like 7-8% of the labor couldn't go any higher than like 20-30 bucks, mm-hmm. at least in a couple of states.
Yeah, and they're still available
they're still
in other
it.
States.
Right. Yeah, in other states. So when you say, hey, we're going to waive that diagnostic fee for you if you do the work, well, what they're really doing is taking that, let's just say it was $150 for diagnostic fee. They're just putting 20 bucks here, 30 bucks there, 40 bucks here, and you don't know any better. They're getting their money.
That's right.
Back, so
they're getting their
you know,
money back.
That,
exactly right. Exactly.
Yeah, and it's like the, you know, we talked about this in pre-show that when you look at like an HVAC or an electrician, they charge you drive time to come to your house. And
right.
what happens if, you know, you know, your HVAC guy is five houses down from you? And then he gets all wrapped up and you get the bill for $140 for drive time. Like, dude, it took you a minute and a half to get here. Sorry, there's drive time.
Right.
You know,
right.
But hey, you want AC or heat, you pay for it. You know,
well,
so
it,
there's,
I mean,
there's
they're
a
upfront about it. They tell you about it up front.
But so do we. We tell you up front that you're
exactly.
getting charged a diagnostic
fee. And that's the incredible part is that in other industries, consumers don't ask that those other industries to waive.
Yeah, yeah, agreed.
Fees.
Agreed.
And it's like you said, it's because we allow it to happen in the automotive industry.
Right.
Right.
Yeah, I agree.
And that
you.
Needs to change. And again, for me, it's a trust factor, right? I trust the guy more that's being upfront saying, I'm charging you a fee to diagnose
oh, yeah, totally.
Your car. Right. And,
yeah, yeah.
And, you know, compare that to dealerships where they have a multi-tier diagnostic system. Right. They have they list it on their menu boards. Tier one, tier two, and tier three. It's 1 hour, 2 hour, 3 hours. So
Yeah. So if they don't get it figured out in that first hour, you're getting a phone call.
Exactly.
And franchise do that too.
A lot of them do. And a lot of these people will have you sign for 2 hours up front so they don't have to make that phone call. And then you have to trust. You have to trust that diagnostic was done in 2 hours, not an hour.
Yes. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, agreed.
And so again.
Look at the we had a dealership that was down the street from our shop when we owned our shop, and they were charging upwards of $400 and something for diag time, guys. $400 and something.
Yeah,
and you had to sign for
front.
It. That was for a check engine light diagnostic. And, and now, granted, it was a European shop, but still, think about that for
it's
a minute.
Not, you, it's
you had
not
to put
that
faith
much harder.
That,
yeah.
Well, you had to put faith that, you know, when you got the phone call that, you know, the guy over the phone was like, hey, we diagnosed it in an hour and 20 minutes. We're only charging that time frame. I guarantee you they probably did not do that. If that guy diagnosed it in an hour, you're getting charged this $400 something odd in diagnostic fees. I'm sorry.
Yes, you are. No, that's absolutely right. And you know, when you go back to your drive time thing, it reminded me of one of our tire suppliers. And this particular supplier had a fuel service charge. So we would pay 75 cents, right? And we knew about it, but we took it for granted. And one day, I think we got a delivery for 3 or 4 separate orders.
And they all had a surcharge.
Each individual
on
order
it.
Had the surcharge. Yep. So when I called our rep and said, hey, man, you were coming out here already. Why are you charging me 3 and 4 different surcharges? Well, it's just how it is on the bill. I can't remove it.
Right.
Okay. Okay. And we found a new tire supplier really quickly, didn't we? Because
yeah. Right? We did that a lot back in the last crash.
They didn't
want to
work with us, right? Again, yeah. You tell me up front there's a service fee. Great. I understand that. But be fair about it, right? I mean, that was the kicker for us. And you know, it's interesting when you look at the evolution of diagnostics.
Yeah, okay? I was just going to go there on that.
Right. Go back 40 or 50 years, ladies and gentlemen, and I can almost guarantee you that as a mechanic, Gary would open a hood, and probably 50% of the time, he would be able to diagnose the car just by opening the hood.
I'm not that old, bro, am I? 40, 50, 60 years.
No, you're not. Damn, you're not, because that would make me old, too. But,
do I need to color my hair or something, man? Okay, I get you with the evolution.
Hair.
So that, that this is the thing, right, folks, is that what he's trying to explain is that when we go back in the day, you know, you just had an engine, a couple of hoses and, you know, some tune-up parts. That's about it. So when you pop the hood, you're like, yeah, you got an oil leak. It's the valve cover gasket. Or you got a coolant leak. It's the radiator or the upper hose, the lower hose, whatever it was in the coolant.
Right.
We've talked about this in previous episodes to where, you know, we have so many coolant hoses now in a car. You can have 5, 6, 7, 8, 10 cooling hoses in a vehicle. Hell, now you got two water pumps, one electric, one manual. And so when we go back into the evolution of the labor and how easy it was to diagnose a car back in the day, things changed as we started to get what I call the dumb boxes.
Right. And I think this is where you're going. Gary, but right, exactly. But even then, 40 years ago, you popped the hood. Okay, you got a sense that it was a coolant leak somewhere. You waived any diagnostic fees, but you still padded the bill for an extra 20 or 30 bucks to make up for that 15 or 20 minutes.
No, that's what I said about the shop labor fee. That's why I brought the labor fee up in the beginning of this, is that we would get 7 to maybe 10% of the labor, and we couldn't charge more than, I think it was like about $11 back in that day. And that's as high as you can go. And so that sort of offset that. I mean, it helped pay for rags and uniforms and stuff like that, but that we didn't really do it as much as you think we did in the industry. Some shops did it. A couple of shops
that
I worked
at did.
You've got an
extra 7% every month of revenue coming in off of labor.
Every ticket would help.
Exactly. And that helped cover some of the cost of free time or some mistakes that might have been made. And then you get into what Gary calls the dummy box, which is labeled OBD1, Onboard Diagnostic 1. And I think you were telling me you got 3 hours of diagnostic time when this,
so
when
back
this was
in the
introduced.
Day, yeah, so back in when I got into the industry in the late 80s, I mean, we had little stupid scanners. You know, we called them the brick or I think OTC had the OTC 1. These things were dumb, okay? You had cartridges you had to put in. But most of the time for a General Motors car, I used a paperclip to diagnose a car. And then I'd put it in the terminal for the computer, and then I would have to count the flashes. So I'd sit there with a clipboard, and that meant two, that meant one.
Right.
And then I'd count all the
codes. Dash lights would flash. Yeah.
Yeah, so the check engine light would flash. And so, like Cadillacs, you'd have to hold on the control panel for the heater control. You'd have to hold off, on, and high, and then that would give you the codes. I mean, it's stupid stuff. Right. But anyway,
it's like doing the hokey pokey to get the car diagnosed. And
yeah, exactly. So then, if you had four codes, the highest code you had to start with first, because that high code probably caused the other codes. And you would take, then you had to go to a book, because we didn't have the computer technology we have today, and you'd have to read up on all the codes. You'd have to look every individual code up, and that high code, because we always use an oxygen sensor, because believe it or not, oxygen sensors can wreak havoc on cars. You had an oxygen sensor code. You go, okay, this is what's causing my other codes probably. And then you would run an oxygen sensor test. Now, granted, that same test that we did with a one-wire oxygen sensor, we still do to this day. It's just now we have four wires.
But going through those processes, you were 2 hours into this easily.
Two and a half. Yeah. And then you'd call the customer up and go, hey, Chris, I got your car diagnosed. It's an O2 sensor, and it's, the 3 hours of diag time, a half an hour to put the sensor in, and the sensor is $60. So you got 3.5 hours of labor plus the part. Okay.
Right.
Then in 1995, OBD2 came into effect. And that's what we are in today. Now, some guys will say, well, we're into OBD3 now. I don't believe that.
Well, they haven't changed the label. It's still two.
Right. Exactly. It's still two. So now the scanner technology has gotten a lot better. And it's made it a little bit more user friendly. I mean, I still, anybody can read a code, folks. Anybody can.
Sure.
But now we only get 1 hour of diagnostic time. And it's an O2 sensor. And I go, hey, Chris, I diagnosed your vehicle. Because now I just have the O2 code, not other codes that follow along with it, probably. I mean, if it sits for a while, you'll get other codes. But that being said, now I'm getting an hour diag time, an hour to replace the sensor, and now your sensor is about $250 to $300, depending on what kind of sensor. It can be an O2 or it can be an air fuel ratio sensor. I've lost time there. So that's why we charge. Go ahead.
Well, I was going to say the shop lost diagnostic time. But with the technology getting better in the scanners, the information coming from the scanner or from the car was much more accurate. So it reduced the time needed to verify any faults found by those codes. And realistically, you know, a shop that does an hour diagnostic, you know, 8 out of 10 of those diags are going to take 40 to 45 minutes.
And yeah, when you get into single source coding, so let's just talk like, you know, an O2 sensor code, let's say a mass airflow sensor code, a coolant temp sensor code, we've gone over this with previous shows. When you're getting into the PO128s, the 1135s, and so on, these are quick, easy codes to diagnose most of the time. When you get into the hard stuff, then I see where you're going to go with this, and I'll let you take it from there where, you know, you're going two and a half hours in the diag time. So.
Well, you're right, because it does happen, right? And it's not with any real frequency. Maybe 1 month it's one in every 40, and the next month it's one in every 60 where the diagnostic
Sometimes it's one every 10.
Yeah, you could have a bad month, and have one in every 10. You're right. Let's talk about
75
customer,
Subarus.
Right? You charge an hour for diagnostic, but the mechanic took 2.5 hours.
Yeah. I mean, let's go back to that.
Majority of these independent repair shops are going to eat that extra time. They are not going to call the customer and ask for additional diagnostic time.
It happens,
but most independent repair shops are eating the time. Dealers and franchises, I would say it's probably an even split 50-50, but I feel like it's a majority where they call and they get the extra time from the customer.
Not franchises, in my opinion. I think franchises would be
dealers for sure.
And, but let's go over the essence of like, well, you know, I got that auto parts store down the street scanned my car for me.
I was going to ask you that. So being that, you know, now scanners are more reliable, why shouldn't I just buy my own little scanner or go to the auto parts store and get my little clue reader, right? This is good for pulling a code, ladies and gentlemen, and that's it. That's all this is good for, to tell you what the code is. But if I know I got an oxygen sensor code, Gary, why don't I just go buy that O2 and bring it to you and have you fix my car?
Okay, so here's the gist. I'll tell you a little story that you probably remember. We had a guy that used to own an auto shop down the street from us, really nice guy. He sold his business when we sold our business, you know, about 6 months apart. He had a customer came in with a Toyota Corolla and needed an engine. The customer was supplying the engine, got it from a junkyard. And the shop owner that we knew said, it's $1,500 to put your engine in. And if that engine's bad that I'm putting in, it's $1,500, man. And the guy's like, nope, the junkyard insured me. It's a good running engine. Right. He put it in. Guess what? Bad engine. It was no good. Yeah. It wouldn't start. Right. And this guy paid $1,500 and then towed his car out. Gave the shop owner $1,500 in cash. Didn't pay with a credit card check. Cash. And then he towed the car away. He didn't get his car fixed. So now, we're talking about an engine to an O2 sensor. But however, what happens if you go to the shop and you say, hey, put an O2 sensor in for me? Well, I'm, as a mechanic, if I get a work order from my dispatcher or my service advisor, install Bank 1 Sensor 102. All I'm going to do is get my tool. I'm going to pop it in, pop it out, plug it in. I'm not going to look at anything. I might be courteous and clear the code for you, but I'm not going to look at readings. There's no reason for me to. I'm losing money if I do that. So I'm going to go boom, 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 and be done. Well, what happens if there's a burnt wire somewhere? And that's what caused the code. That's why folks pay for diagnostic time. It's important to pay for diagnostic time.
Because when these situations arise, it's natural for the consumer to look at the shop and say, something happened. You did something wrong. And they expect you to give free diagnostic time at that point. And it became an argument almost every single time this situation arose. And in our business, we wouldn't allow you to bring a part to us unless you were an established customer. And then we had the conversation about if this doesn't work, you're still paying for it. And
yeah, but we had that
for anything.
Yeah, right, we had that few and far between, though.
I know, but we eventually just did away with this type of work to avoid the problem from the beginning, right? Even with our existing customers, I'm sorry, we can't do that. And so it's you know, akin to using the internet to try and fix your car, right? There's value in that sometimes.
You don't go to the dentist, man, and say, okay, you clean my teeth, and you say I have two cavities, you're going to waive the cleaning away. The dentist is going to look at you and go, no.
You
I just paid a hygienist to clean your teeth.
Exactly, and we're paying mechanics to do the diagnostic on your car. And so, again,
guys,
this
is just so you know, this is all about check engine light diagnostics, cars that don't start diagnostics. We're not talking about, oh, I need a light bulb put in, and it's right then and there. You know,
sure.
it doesn't have to do with that. We're talking about hard time diagnostics. You know, something that's going to take a mechanic an hour, 2 hours to do. So, okay, so and I think we got a good gist of where we're at with, you know, the diag fees and just the generalization for you folks that, you know, when a mechanic or a shop says, hey, you know, if you do all the work, I'll waive the fee. Trust us, they're not waiving the fee. They're padding the bill in other areas. They're taking that chance that you're going to do the work, and they're taking their diag fee and they're spreading it across all of the line items that are
on there.
Because the only way we make money is parts and labor. Those are the only two things that we can do to make money in a shop is parts and labor.
And they're padding the bill, folks. And this is, I'm glad you mentioned that, Gary. I'm glad you mentioned that because we need to explain how diagnostic fees are calculated. Okay, because again, there's two sources of revenue, parts and labor, and that is broken down by the hour. So the shop knows exactly how much money is being made per hour. And
it's a one-to-one.
A one-to-one.
You want 100 bucks in parts, 100 bucks in labor.
When you take the parts out of the equation, we have to make up the money lost by not having parts. So what happens is, let's just say the labor rate for the shop is $100 an hour. The diagnostic fee for that shop is going to be about $140 to $150. And that's to make up for the fact that there's no parts being used within the hour of that labor. And that is correct. That is the right thing to do for the shop, right?
I never understood why shops didn't do that. Like where they go with just 1 hour, 1 hour is their door rate and that's it. But that makes no sense to me.
I mean,
if you're a shop listening to this, charge more money.
Charge more money because again, isn't there more integrity from somebody? No, this is my fee. It does not get waived away. My time is valuable. I have a service to offer you. If you wish to partake in my service, this is the fee. And when they stand firm on that, that integrity for me makes me think, wow, this person really knows what they're doing. They believe in what they're doing. And I think that that person there is going to be charging fairly across the board at all times.
That's a good way of ending this in that, you know, looking at and we always saying to the customer, to you folks, that when you look at a shop that's charging you accordingly, and we're going to wrap it up here on this, is that you charge me for a fuse. Well, yeah, I put a fuse in your car.
Right.
You need to be charged for the fuse. Nothing's free, folks. Okay.
Nothing.
So I think we got a good amount of this coming back for the first time, you know, being in split screen. I think we did a good job, folks. Hey, look, we've been saying this while I was gone. We got a lot of videos on YouTube now, and we're really asking you guys, leave a comment. You know, we're really, really wanting to know what you guys think.
What you guys are thinking.
You know, we've said it before in other shows that we've been doing that, you know, it's all automotive. So we'd like to know what you guys want too, but we really want to see some comments. You know, we really appreciate the people that have come on board already, you know,
subscriptions are rising. We're doing
the likes are good and everything, but we really want to see comments, guys. So do us a favor, subscribe to the video,
that bell and share it as much as you can.
Yeah, please share it. And thanks for watching, guys. And we'll see you next week.
Stay safe.
Remember, finding great car service starts with an investigation.